this, and yeah, yeah, oh, 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 everything's good except my face froze. Classic. Classic Skype. Oh well, whatever. I'll work on it as we talk.
Par for the course, my friend.
Why Skype? Why? So,
yeah. I just seem to remember you stating that Skype was dead.
It would be if you would cooperate with me and just use Discord for whatever.
I tried, dude. We tried,
no,
remember?
No, you're a Skype fanboy.
Okay.
I am Sahara Drak of StormLegacy.com, and this is episode, I believe, 45. Yeah, 45 of Nexus Drafthouse, where we talk about drafts and only drafts, and the goal is to help you as a viewer and a player better understand pro drafting and also improve your own drafting in your games. It's a crucially vital part of Heroes of the Storm is the draft phase, and it can lead to victory or defeat in a lot of cases. So,
all roads run through drafting.
That's right. Every single road.
That's right.
I'm with my co-host Ryan, Lord of Ascension Tower here. Look at him smiling. Hey, he's beaming. He's beaming.
It's a good day.
It's almost time for
BlizzCon.
It's almost time for BlizzCon. You excited?
That's right. See? Yeah, I'm absolutely excited.
Yeah.
Are you?
You can't tell I'm excited because my face is frozen on your screen, but yeah, I'm excited.
Yeah, it's a little bit, but that's okay. Yeah.
And with us tonight, we have David Connell, the head coach and draft coach, like drafter, for the recent HGC entrance through the Crucible Heroes Hearth. How's it going, man?
It's going pretty well. How about yourself?
Not bad. So usually we have guests on here, and a lot of people kind of know who they are, but you're a little bit more behind the scenes guy. So why don't you tell us about your history in Heroes and how you got started and what you do now?
All right. So I'll try to keep this a bit shorter, but I started off as Heroes as probably a Bronze 5 player. A long time ago, I got an alpha invite to Heroes. I started playing. It was my first MOBA ever. And then I worked my way up through the ranks and just through thousands and thousands of games. I probably have like nearing 15,000 now, right?
Wow.
And yeah, I just got to rank one in preseason and then came out kicking as Grandmaster, right?
Very good.
It became a big part of my life at that point because when you're playing thousands of games, right? You know,
that's a time commitment.
That's a lot. Yeah, yeah.
It's a big thing. And one of my friends wanted to get into the game with me, right?
Mm-hmm.
And this was about 2 years ago. I taught him from the ground up, and I realized that there was something I really liked to do was to give my knowledge of, you know, the game to other people. And I realized that I had sort of a more analytical mindset than maybe some other people who played the game, who played it by feel, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's a common concept that I've seen, is that many people play by feel instead of playing by the numbers, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And so off of that, I got inspired to found my company, Nihilism Gaming. And then I coached people for 2 years, individuals, and I would occasionally pop in and out of, you know, just a variety of teams, practices, and sort of help them out.
Nice.
And then that's sort of how it all started.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got involved with Heroes Hearth when they were having tryouts for coaches. And so I just went in for a tryout. The guys loved me, right? And it was all peachy from there. And
so you're a self-made esports man. That's cool.
Yeah, I like to think of it that way.
Started at the bottom, now you're here. Yeah,
that's right. That's right. The road. That's impressive.
That's good. Well, I'm sure you were very happy with your team recently. They kind of dominated throughout the entire Open Division phase. Things got a little scary towards the end, but you guys made it through. And now you are all preparing, I'm sure, fervently to become an HGC competitor. And just as a little not everybody's going to know what that's like. So what is it like transitioning from the Open Division to the HGC?
Well, to be completely fair, I might not be the right person to ask this because I had never been so heavily invested in an Open Division team before this, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not quite sure what it is to be a pro team yet because we haven't started until January, right?
Mm-hmm.
But
go ahead. Sorry. I was going to ask if anything's changed.
Well, the big thing that's changed is that I now know that this is potentially a viable career path for me.
Mm-hmm.
So, and the spring, I had graduated college, right? And I was trying to figure out what to do with my life, right? And send out applications, right? You know? And still just doing my thing with nihilism and coaching, and I saw the team, right? And then that's when I joined the team. And now there was a couple months of uncertainty when, you know, it was applying for jobs and waiting to hear back from, you know, places like Morgan Stanley, right? Yeah, because I was
a little different career path here.
I was an economics and finance major at my college, right, which is a college that is well known for business, right? And so it was very different. But I actually think there is one tie-in here, right? Because a lot of the courses I took in college were related to corporate strategy, right? And so I brought it all back together. And so instead of doing corporate strategy, I now do esports strategy.
Ooh, I like that. I like that turn of phrase there.
Yeah, that's, I mean, that means you can apply the things you're obviously good at and do it towards things that you really enjoy, like
hobby. Yeah, it really lends to your analytical mindset going into this.
Yeah.
So you can see how those backgrounds are similar.
Well, this is definitely a very good start to your dabblings or your ambitions towards esports stuff. So congratulations to you and your team.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah. So I guess before we get started on the draft, what is it? Are you practicing or scrimming differently? Do you do all that stuff with your team? Do you like oversee scrims and stuff, or are you more like an analyst? Okay.
I do everything. I am part analyst, part coach, and I also draft. As far as I know, I'm the only coach in North America that drafts.
Yeah.
And so that's both a lot of responsibility and trust from my teammates to give me, right?
And I guess so since we're talking about draft and this is a draft show, what would you say your draft style is? Are you a reactive drafter? Do you like to do you like to make certain kind of comps in this meta? What sort of things do you have in your pocket?
And to add on to that, like how do you how much of a plan going in versus how much changes on the fly? I'm always really curious about that.
There's a big plan going in. So there's two different styles of drafting that we work on, right? And one of them is this sort of meta flow chart style of drafting, right? Where we play, the way I like to think of it is where we play rock, paper, scissors, right? You go this comp, we go that comp, and suddenly paper beats rock, right?
Right.
And that would be the more reactive style of drafting. So we do prepare for that, and that's something we've been working on. But to do that, you have to know how to play more compositions, right? When we look at specific compositions, we sort of look at more like specific styles of play, per se, than a specific composition, right? So we say we have a composition, but we can substitute these heroes for that hero, right? And along those lines. So that we have a game plan, and there's a lot of heroes that do similar things that can, you know, sort of be interchanged to customize, right? And the only time that we really do that is when we think it's overpowering, like super strong on one map, like overwhelmingly strong, right? And so when we have an overwhelmingly strong composition, we might just draft right into it, because then we're not worried about rock, paper, scissors, because, you know,
it doesn't matter, right?
Yeah, because maybe the hydraulic press beats them all, right?
Right.
So how long do you think would you say it takes for the scene, maybe in North America specifically, to settle into a meta that's predictable enough for you to draft around?
Well, we're in a really weird state right now, where the game is balanced enough that there is a lot of things that can be played, right? The meta seems to change about every week or two, right? And so it's really, really fast paced. And that being said, I have to be very fast paced to keep up, right?
Sure. What does that time commitment look like? I mean, just as far as following the meta, like what does it take to understand the meta and see trends develop and pass out of play?
And is it hard to like identify, like when do you know something's meta or something just worked for that game, you know?
I think it's easier to identify when you don't know what the meta is, right? Because I came into it. Well, when I first started coaching, it was my first foray into really HGC Open and actually working with a single team for a long period of time. Beforehand, I had been with a few teams, and you know, I just come in sort of occasionally, right? Mm-hmm. It wasn't a big time sink or anything like that, right? So when I first came in, I wasn't following the meta or any of the pro teams or any even the open teams, right? And I had sort of no idea what I was doing with the draft, right? And so the initial commitment here was that I sat down and I watched hundreds and hundreds of games, right? Hundreds of pro games to understand what we were looking at, right? Mm-hmm. And after that, right, I had a good idea of the meta. And then when things didn't make sense, I knew that we had to adapt, right? If we sure. ran into something in scrims, it was like, what is even happening? Why are we losing, right? Mm-hmm. The it looks like it should all be good here, right? And that's when we know we need to adapt, right?
Okay. Is it pretty easy to see, you know, a difference in, you know, when you're analyzing games, whether or not it was a draft win or loss versus, you know, maybe a poor play or better play? Some of those things kind of blur depending on who you're playing against. Well,
I think I try to separate them with my team because there's a couple of questions that I always pose to my teammates both before and after the draft. I say, how does the draft look, right? And they say beforehand, it looks pretty good, right? And then I ask them, how did the draft feel, right? Mm-hmm. And I like to describe my job as partly quantifying their feelings, right? So if they say the draft was fine and we just messed up, right? Well, then that's, you know, that's probably obviously, true. Yeah. right? Because I can watch the games all day, right? But if they know how to play it, right, in some miracle way that I don't understand, right, mm-hmm. then it still works out, right? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So it's partly watching the games and seeing the mistakes and seeing if we can execute. And if we can't execute, another consideration to take into mind is some things are harder to play, and maybe that just makes them worse, right?
But how do you separate that out? Right? When you look at a game and you lost, how do you know if it was a draft loss versus, you know, they didn't execute perfectly in this one situation and it all just fell apart from there?
Okay, I guess my idea is if you're passively winning or passively losing, right? And if you're passively winning, then I think it's a draft win. Mm-hmm. And if you're passively losing and then you make a miracle play and win the game, right, then maybe it's a draft loss, right?
Right. Well, that makes sense. Yeah.
That's the better way to look at it, I think.
I guess, yeah, if you look at the whole frame of the game outside of the big play that you screwed up and we lost, oh no. But if you were, like, winning the rest of the game and you were naturally trending towards winning that game through normal play, that was probably you drafted right, yeah.
But there are heroes and comps that get power spikes, right? So
like hard to tell. Level 20, right, is mm-hmm. a huge power spike, right? Mm-hmm. And so one way you would analyze that is we say, okay, well, the composition can take so much damage, right? We would assign, so specifically for Nazebo, right, one of the ways I look at it is that if we lose a keep on Tomb of the Spider Queen, we failed, right? Mm-hmm. So it's like we defend the keeps until level 20, right? And then we win, right? Because mm-hmm. as long as there's no catapults pushing on the lanes on Tomb of the Spider Queen, the spiders are going to still work, right? Right. And so mm-hmm. once we get Vial Infection level 20, our spiders are still effective. This is a win, right?
Okay.
Yeah. And so there, you can set certain metrics, right? If you have an early game composition, you need to get reliably ahead early on, right? And that's not happening, then there's something wrong with the play, right?
Right.
And or you've been countered, right?
Right.
And that's where the difficulty comes in, right? And you go back to the replay and you say, okay, are we executing the things that we need to execute, our win conditions, right? You're running a Kerrigan composition. You want to make kills early on. You want to put pressure on your enemies. You want to force them to back. You want to force them to play respectfully in your presence, right? Or mm-hmm. when you're missing and from the map, right? Sure. All the time, pretty much.
So, okay. So you were telling me that you, some of the teams that you admire as far as drafting ability were European teams. And teams like Team Expert, who everybody gets, you know, they have very exciting drafts. ADRD does off-meta stuff that works in new ways, and it's always really cool to see. So we went ahead and did a game from a couple weeks ago, early October, from the HGC Phase 2, between Team Wish and Team Expert here. on Infernal Shrines, and this was the final game of the series. How do you feel about Infernal Shrines in the current meta, and is it one of your, is it a map you like for your team or not?
No, it's not a map I like for my team. Well, it's a map my team likes, but it's not a map I like.
Right. Okay.
And because we see things very different ways, this is a map that we're very good on, right? It's a map that's easy to understand, easy to shot call, easy to play, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that isn't something that I want from us, right? I want us to be able to be able to play well on the maps that are hard, right?
Right.
The maps that are difficult and that we can make difficult for our opponents, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And so ideally, this is not my ideal map, but okay. It is a map that my team is currently pretty good at.
Okay, got you.
It does help to have a reliable pocket win. I mean, right?
Yeah.
I need it. So.
Yeah, you of course. Yeah, I'm sure that's always nice to have to fall back on a map you're comfortable on. Yeah, but looking at Infernal Shrines in the current meta, what sort of things do you think work here?
I think, okay. Let me dive into a big topic real quick for you.
Okay.
So my team has allowed me to talk about this, so I'm really excited to bring it to you guys today, right?
Awesome.
And there are three major meta strategies out there, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right now. Okay. And it works exactly like rock, paper, scissors, right?
Sure.
Not even kidding. Exactly like rock, paper, scissors. We have the double global strategy, right? Where you pick up globals, you win into the late game. We have a strategy I like to call the 1-1-3, and this is where you will have healers such as Oriole and the Medic. You'll have double support hyper carry, right?
Right.
And they'll work as a little three-man pod. And then finally, we have a strategy called the 2-3 Rat, which was made famous by Roll20, actually, was the one who started it here. And this is where you stack your solo lane with two people.
Mm-hmm.
And so on two lane maps, you'll run a 2-3.
Okay.
And then on three lane maps, it's a 2-1-2, right? So you have pretty much two pods of two people on opposite sides of the map, right?
Mm-hmm.
And okay. These three strategies, they work as rock, paper, scissors, right?
Okay.
So the 2-3 rat with the split up lanes punishes the double globals early on because both sides push. And if you try to react to one, they push on the other, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And then the 1-1-3 is able to defend against the 2-3 rat, right? And then the double global beats the 1-1-3, right?
Okay, so I do, but why does the 1-1-3 defend against the rat?
So the 1-1-3 defends against the rat because you have one person in the solo lane to soak, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they can hold off some damage, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then the three people in the bottom lane render the two people more useless than the two people on top render one, right?
Okay.
And so you get like a little advantage by having three versus two rendering the two people scared, right? Versus two versus one rendering one person scared.
Right.
And then also later into the game, you run double support comps into double support comps, and the stronger sustain supports win,
right?
Which are the ones in the 1-1-3.
Okay.
Because those are the ones you have Oriole, you have the Medic, right?
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, that's interesting. So
that is interesting.
So would you say that cycle, that rock, paper, scissors cycle applies to every map in the game right now?
Most maps.
Okay.
There are a few that you cannot run the strategies on,
right?
So like Braxis Holdout, you can't run a 1-1-3 really because there's only two lanes.
Right, sure.
Right. Double globals, always been a thing on it.
Mm-hmm.
The rat always been a thing on it too. But there are some maps where this can break down, and pretty much when you cannot execute a strategy reliably on one of those maps, it breaks down, right? Any one of the three strategies.
So with that rock, paper, scissors mentality, how it seems like the very beginning of the draft becomes some of the most important because you don't want to give away which of the three strategies you're going.
Exactly.
Right? So what is the typical approach then to, is it just picking up strong heroes no matter what for all three comps? I mean, what's kind of the typical mindset going into that early draft?
Well, the way that I like to think about it is that there are certain heroes that do not show your strategy and are really strong, right? So we call these the meta OPs, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so the meta OPs right now would be like ETC, right? Well, not counting the newest patch, right? We're talking ETC, Grey Mane, and possibly Mathiel, right?
Okay.
And so picking up any of those three heroes lets you not show your strategy and lets you win the rock, paper, scissors, shape, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the other way you can play it is you can play niche comps, right? Because if you see that your enemy is going a certain one of these comps, right, you don't have to play rock, paper, scissors. You could play, you know, a wombo comp. You could play something else, right? Just depending on what they're going and how you plan to beat it, right? But so rock, paper, scissors is just like the start of what we got here.
Right.
Okay. But that, it seems pretty dangerous in draft where you could get, you know, suckered into going in, or you have a plan to go into a niche comp and then you end up getting just obliterated in the draft if you're not careful.
Right. Now, yeah, that was going to be my question. If you see, like, let's say you see an early Ariel pick or something, and you're like, okay, I know which of the three they're leaning towards. Can you shut that down on the draft screen, or is there enough options to where it's kind of hard to do?
So there are so many options for both niche and meta comps that if you first pick Oriole, it gives away your hand, right?
Right.
Because Oriole's a hero that very much says, I'm going to play this one style, right? Or I guess if you really wanted to, maybe you could try to fit it into the rat, right? But it's not so great there.
Yeah.
But you're really leaning towards that 1-1-3 style, and playing anything else would be suboptimal at that point, right? Or right. Unless it's like Cho'Gall, maybe, sure. Right?
Right. Which is definitely a thing in Korea, but yeah.
Korea, yeah, not so much here.
Well, I've had some crazy ideas for Cho'Gall.
Apparently, I mean, they love him, so we'll probably see him at BlizzCon at some point. Okay, so let's get into this game real quick so we can think about those ideas you just presented about the meta and the three major styles in pro play, and maybe try to apply them to these drafts we're watching. So Team Wish opens up with the ban on Medivh, and Team Expert bans Tassadar. I don't think either of those are too shocking. The Medivhs you don't always see, but it depends on who's playing who. But obviously this is Team Expert, and he's ADRD very well known for his Medivhs. So anything? Oh, what's up?
You have this game was played on Tomb.
Oh, is it? Oh, I'm sorry. I was looking at the wrong map. Tomb of the Spider Queen. Yeah, I can change that real quick.
Okay.
Okay, so Medivh and Tassadar bans.
So any thoughts looking, on that? Yeah. I have something I could bring to that. Mm-hmm. Okay. So looking at those bans, right? This is Tomb of the Spider Queen, right?
Mm-hmm.
Let's start disregarding the map. Just completely just forget we have a map, right? Mm-hmm. This is just game of drafts, right?
Sure. Just a big arena. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So we have 71 heroes in the game right now, and there are very few of them that deal well with burst damage, right?
Mm-hmm.
And one of them that deals well with burst damage is Medivh. Another one is Tassadar, right?
Right.
That being said, if ADRD, known for Medivhs on the other team, you're going to want to ban out the Medivh, right?
Mm-hmm.
And on Tomb of the Spider Queen, Tassadar is insanely powerful. Right. There are a few maps where it's like this, where Tassadar is really powerful, right? Like this map, and Towers of Doom is another one, which I can think of, right?
Okay.
I believe he has some absurdly high win rate, like 60 or 70% in pro games on those two maps, right?
Okay.
And so that's my thinking here, is that we start by either it's a preference ban, or it's a ban to reduce the number of people who have burst shielding, right? Or sure. Defense, right? Burst defense, we'll call it, right?
Yeah.
And then it's a counter saying, okay, Tassadar is really freaking good on this map. And also, it does the same thing, so let's try to choke them out of it, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so do you think that would dissuade both teams from making a heavy burst comp? Or do you think...
I think it would incentivize them to.
Incentivize.
Well, yeah, because you banned them out.
Yeah, because you banned out the counters to that, right?
Sure.
Right.
So, it seems like, as we just spoke about, that neither of these bans really gives much of anything away because they're just insanely powerful and don't really aren't necessary in any comps here, right?
Yeah. They're not crucial elements to any of those three things. Like, I don't think there's probably not one hero that, except for maybe the Ariel for the one thing, that completely enables or disables one of those three strategies, right? Like,
well, yeah, if you get rid of the Oriole and the medic, the 1-1-3 is a little bit off the table. Right. You could also run it with a Tassadar potentially, because you just need a hero that enables your hyper carry to have some extra health, and so you can trade, right? So the 1-1-3 is about one-on-one trading power, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so Oriole lets you do that because you get efficiency out of Pope. Medic lets you do it better because you get just like free heals and you just keep trading, right? And eventually, if you're Oriole versus the Medic, right, and you're on a one-on-one, the Medic, eventually the Hope gen for Oriole needs to back off, right? And so Tassadar also enables this trading type of behavior, right? This one-on-one damage, right?
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. Absolutely. I was just wondering, you know, if at what point is a strategy off the table, I guess? And 113 is probably the easiest to remove, you would think, because of the Aurel Medic, or globals?
Well, they're all rather difficult to remove because there's more than two globals. There's more than two people that can enable the 113 because we have Oriole, Medic, Tassadar, right?
Right, okay.
That can so enable
the
113.
The Tassadar option. Okay, I got you.
Yeah.
So Team Wish does first pick the Grey Mane here on Tomb of the Spider Queen. Nice wave clear. Just a solid hero pretty much everywhere. Do you like this as a first pick choice?
I think it's pretty okay. I think their options here are Grey Mane or ETC or maybe potentially even Mathiel, right? Mm-hmm. Mathiel's a bit weak on this map due to his weak wave clear, right?
Right.
And Grey Mane doesn't show, Mathiel doesn't show, ETC doesn't show. So I think this is a good pick for them. I'm just wondering if the ETC might have been a better pick for them, right? Because the ETC maybe is just a bit stronger than Grey Mane. Grey Mane has a little bit of faltering win rates over time.
Mm-hmm.
In HGC, I think he's somewhere around like 45 to 50-ish percent, like not positive win rates, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. So they might have just statistically hurt themselves a tiny bit if you can even consider the data reliable, right?
Now that I guess that leads to a question though: how much of your drafting when you're drafting for Heroes Hearth is straight up the numbers, and how much do you have to adjust your draft advice based on, well, Crowan really likes Greymane, or you know,
right?
Comfort picks.
So we're very lucky. I'm very lucky that I have a team that's incredibly flexible, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so it's less that I need to adjust for the players and more that we need to adjust for what the team considers to be good. Because like I said, the data isn't always great, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because you have teams that prioritize one hero. Like if I looked at the data on Medivh, right? We would have teams that play Medivh and teams that don't play Medivh, right? And if only the good teams play Medivh, right, suddenly Medivh's win rate gets super biased and high, right?
Right.
And so the data in pro games, you don't have that many games, and it's often not great data, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I sort of try to take two different standpoints, and I say, okay, players, you have a feeling that something is good. Let me see if I can verify it by data. Or I see data, this seems like insane, right? Let's see if I can verify it by the players, right?
Right.
And I try to bridge that gap between the two.
Okay, I got you.
All right.
So moving back over, the first two picks on Team Expert side, they do pick up that ETC who is came back into the meta a couple of months ago and has been prominently in the early picks, just like the old days where it
very
was
solid.
ETC every day, all day. He went away for about 2 weeks and then now he's back again where he always was. So, and then they do a Vala as their second pick. So Vala, the Tassadar is not on the table. They banned it, but the Aurel is potentially still there, and with an ETC. So what do you think of the Vala second pick? Obviously ETC kind of speaks for itself, but you can also talk about ETC if you'd like.
So ETC, like you said, speaks for itself.
Mm-hmm.
Vala is very good too. So Vala is a very strong hero, right?
Right.
But it also shows your strategy at this point, right?
Does this indicate right off the bat double support?
This does not necessarily. I think it does indicate double support, actually. Because, like, if we go back to our framework, right, we have the rat or we have the 113
right.
on the table, right? And if you're going to take a sustained single target auto attack damage, right, it's going to come back to one of those two strategies, right?
Right.
And so I think that this is solid, right? Because if you have both of those strategies on the table, one of them beats double globals, one of them loses to double globals, right? And so you actually have not fully committed to one strategy or the other, right?
Mm-hmm.
In this
not
case.
Yet,
yeah. Okay.
So the Vala, so just not tipping the hand too much, but definitely indicating leaning towards one of those
double support. Right?
Yeah. So going back over to Team Wish, we have a Lucio Johanna, which Lucio has also been more prominent lately. And this is considered Johanna's, one of her, well, actually her best map for Wave Clear purposes. Any thoughts on what this now tells you about Team Wish's comp?
Okay. Well, the first thing I would think of if I was in their position and just the gray main was on the board right now, I would say, okay, I see that they have a Vala, right? And so one thing that I like to talk about is that there are three different types of damage and three different types of healing, not counting separating by ability and auto attack and stuff like that. I'm talking about sources, right? We have single target damage, right? We have multi-target damage, right? And hold on, what was the third one?
Poison? Like
slow, yeah, AoE, slow. Target. Stumble in here.
That's okay. Take your time.
Okay. We have AoE and single burst. Okay. Yeah. There we go. Burst. AoE single target and burst, right?
Right.
Okay.
So sustained single target and burst single target. Is that?
Yes. Okay. Okay. Yeah. There's sustained single target. There's sustained multi-target, and then there is burst single target. That's what I was trying to get at. Right.
No worries.
Okay. Three types of damage, right? Vala brings certain types of damage to the table, right? We normally see Q build Vala, right? And I think of this as a bit more of sustained single target damage, right? Yeah. If we see multi-shot Vala, that's multi-target damage, right?
Right.
And so this is why the Lucio pick is a bit questionable to me, because they've mix-matched, right? They have single target damage on the other team, but multi-target healing on your team, right?
Right. AoE and so, healing, yeah.
Yeah, so that's why this is a bit odd to me, right?
Do you see Lucio as a single healer? A viable single healer?
I see him as a multi-target healer, because he has AoE healing, and I also see him as a nice provider of sound barriers.
Oh, no, I think he was asked, so you can't, you don't consider him a solo healer, though? You would like a second support with him?
Do you put him in as an only healer on a team?
Lucio can be an only healer on a team, yes.
Okay.
Most healers can be.
Right.
I think that's something we've seen oscillate between various guests.
Right,
we've had
it changes.
On here.
Yeah, people's opinions on that change are vary. A lot of people think that there are certain supports that simply cannot be a solo support, and some of our guests have thought Lucio is one of those that can't do it. So,
go ahead. Allow me to go on a bit of a tangent here. I'd love to talk about why we have double support meta in the first place.
Please,
and I'd love to hear your guys' thoughts on that, and then I'll echo it with what I think.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Go for it.
So why I think that we have double support meta is because I think one support is greater than one assassin, right? If we look at the pure damage numbers compared between supports and assassins, right? They're not also different, right? We look at the amount of damage an assassin does with an ability, and the amount of support that, like, a healer like Lucio or Rhaegar or any of the other ones do with a heal. There's a vast difference, right? And so you actually don't give up much power in terms of your health, your auto attack damage, right? And stuff like that to pick up a healer over an assassin, right?
Right.
So my theory is currently that the healing abilities are stronger than the damage abilities numerically, by a lot, right? By a ton.
Sure.
Right.
Absolutely.
And so that's why double healer is preferred, right? Because one healer greater than one assassin is what it comes down to, right?
Right.
And so you wonder why we don't have, you know, three healers, why not have four healers, right?
Right.
And I think it's because there's a certain framework in the meta you need to stick to at all points in time, right? And I think that framework is one tank, one healer, one ranged assassin, one utility pick, and a solo laner, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
That's the basic and, like, general comp.
And so the only way you can actually add another support character in is to put them in place of the utility pick, right?
Right.
Unless you want to go into atypical comps, which are weird and they're not understood well, but you know, and maybe it'll work,
it can work.
But maybe it's the Rhaegar as your solo laner, right?
But there are a few heroes that hit both utility and that second heal, right? Like Tassar is the typical example, right? Where you're getting both utility and
I think the utility pick can be pretty much anything. A utility pick is, this is how we're gonna tech our comp out, right?
Right.
You don't need to actually have any utility on that pick, right?
That's fair.
Just fills a space for how they want to run it. I see what you're saying.
Right.
So
Yeah.
the double healer meta. I guess what you're saying is that pound for pound, a support is more efficient than an assassin. So having two is never a bad thing. And I think going into three, that's where you get your diminishing returns starting to come.
Well,
in.
Right, you end up there's an apex, we just
can't kill anything, you know, like yeah.
Yeah. And you also, like, if you have two supports, two damage characters, if you're very good at damage type matching, so like you see here, we have a mixed match between single target damage from Vala and Lucio, right? Mm-hmm. Lucio with AoE healing. There's a mixed match here. And so the teams that are very good at mix matching well are the ones that are going to come out on top, right? Because right now, Team Expert has a bit of the upper hand, right? Because mm-hmm. they have a damage type that does not match the healing type on the other team, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think this is where it comes from, is that people realize that they exploit this advantage, right?
Right.
But if I was Team Expert right now, I would expect Team Wish to pick up another Uther. Healer later
yeah.
in the draft,
I would just
right?
Be like, they're going to get Uther, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And Uther is a burst single target healer, right?
Right.
So they still haven't made up for the sustained single target, right?
Right.
And that's so true. They're
but there are other options still on the table, right? I mean, it's
yes,
the, still the medic or mm-hmm. a couple others.
Yeah, the medic or the Oriole would have been a fantastic pick for Team Wish.
Yeah.
I think over the Lucio.
Over the Lucio, yeah.
But now it's
Anyways, yeah, so yeah. It's going into the ban phase, so we'll see what they do. Real quick on the Johanna. Johanna, do you agree that Johanna has a lot of value on this map and it's a decent pick?
So is this the pre-patch Johanna or the post-patch Johanna?
This is pre. Oh. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely lots of value on this map.
Yeah.
It's a good pick because Johanna is a tank that I used to refer to as the king of sustain, right?
Right.
She not only has blinds for the Vala, but she has an enormous amount of self-health regeneration, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so if you're going for a slow fight, Johanna is a perfect tank.
Just the best
and
choice.
That's why we see her picked up in double support meta, or at least we used to see her picked up in double support meta, because
mm-hmm.
she gets Regeneration Master, she gets Laws of Hope, well, the old one did, Regeneration yeah. Master, Laws of Hope,
right.
And you get 80 health regeneration per second, right? And you just, if it's a long, you know, double support team fight,
right.
80 health regeneration per second for, you know, 20 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And a free self-cleanse, right?
Right.
Free
and the iron skin is huge, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Exactly. You get all those things on top of each other, which makes her a fantastic choice. And finally, she's really good into ETC, too.
Right.
Because it exploits a lot of ETC's weaknesses, which is weak wave, clear before 7, has an interrupt for mosh pit, because you can self-cleanse and then condemn it.
Really
right?
reliable mosh interrupt, yeah.
Yeah, and it's also great for the map, right?
Yeah, we get
the
gems. Yeah. Okay, so
a lot of value here.
Solid picks, yeah. So going in the second ban phase, Team Expert does ban out the Malthael ban, and Team Wish bans Chromie. So you were talking about the Malthael possibility here a little bit earlier. Do you think this is the ideal ban here for Team Expert, or what do you think this... What does this tell you about what Team Expert's doing this when you see these picks with this ban?
So Malthael is generally really good into double support, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's also good into a variety of solo laners, and he's actually not so good against a variety of other solo laners, right?
Okay.
And so when I see the Malthael ban coming out, I'm thinking, okay, well, definitely double support, but we sort of already knew that from
the
Vault
pick,
yeah.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And the second thing that I'm thinking is that maybe they want a soul laner that has a really bad matchup into the Malthael, right?
Mm-hmm.
Such as maybe a Dahaka or Leoric doesn't fare too well.
Right.
Everyone, a variety of others, right?
So, okay, yeah. I mean, it just kind of lends into more of what you were saying about their comp so far, so it makes sense. The Chromie...
Do you ever see bans used as... misdirection tools? Like, it's been a couple drafts where we've been puzzled by the bans, and we're very, very curious if they're just red herrings to try to throw the other team off of where your comp's headed.
I think that sometimes you get bad drafts. I think especially when you don't have somebody very, very dedicated to crafting a draft, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or looking at drafts. You end up with just bad choices sometimes, right?
Right.
Within the draft.
Right.
So sometimes when you're puzzled, it might just be for good reason, right?
So you would never intentionally throw a ban to try to
I'm not saying that I wouldn't.
Because I know we've seen, we did at least one Fnatic game, I know, where I don't know because I didn't talk to Fnatic, but it really looked like they used a ban as a bait, like, and totally threw off the other team. So I think it's something that's possible, but I think a lot of times it's pretty rare.
And it seems you have to be pretty confident in your drafting ability too.
They were playing a team they were like way outclassing already, so like they probably did it because it was safe. Yeah.
Or you first ban out a new Barak, right? And everybody goes, "Oh, Cho'Gall, better ban it," right?
Right. Exactly. Yeah. That sort of
thing. Make them waste the ban. Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, so okay. The Chromie ban, I think, leads into what you're saying about the Team Wish is relying on Lucio right now, and he cannot handle a Chromie combo. Like, that's rough for him with his slow AoE healing. With all the other damage flying around, it kind of, if someone gets put in a temporal loop, he doesn't have cleanse, and then he can't really, unless he sound barriers, save that person from Chromie's combo. So I think that's what the Chromie ban's for. Any additional ideas on the Chromie ban there?
I think EU in particular has a bit of favoritism for Chromie right now, especially on Tomb of the Spider Queen and Dragon Shy, right?
Okay.
And so I'm not surprised to see the Chromie ban, because I think they're thinking, okay, it's an OP hero that we'd have trouble dealing with. There's not that many cleanses left on the table on heroes that are halfway decent, right? Unless we want to pick up, you know, Lili, right? I mean, there's the Brightwing Ragoff.
They could pick up Radar, yeah.
That's true. Yeah.
But maybe they didn't want to be forced into that position, right?
Yeah, I kind of lean towards that too. Where if it was me, I would, if Chromie is makes sense, especially when you have this Lucio healer, it's just such a tough hero to deal with if you don't have the right tools, you know. So to me, I like the ban. Yeah.
If you look at their tank too, they're never going to be able to get to her.
Right. She's not going to falling sword her. Yeah.
Engage tools.
Yeah, that's not her thing. Is hard engage. Yeah. Okay, so Team Expert does actually get the Uther here, since they had the first pick after the second ban phase. So they pick up the Uther and the Sonya for the solo lane. Looking like a really, really stout team so far, like really beefy.
Yeah, I really like the Uther pickup into the gray main. I mean, to protect the Vala, what are your thoughts on the first healer being Uther here?
I think that it's a great pickup. If we look at Gray Main's damage typing, he is burst single target damage, right? That's where his big threat comes from. His big threat isn't from him trying to poke down your team. It's not spreading a Sylvanas dagger everywhere, right?
Right.
It's a really solid pickup because it shuts down the burst damage from the Gray Main, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very, very effectively, yeah. And the Sonya, would you have rather had a Leo here, or do you like the Sonya?
So Sonya is, I think of her as a sort of jack of all trades piece, right? One, because my player McIntyre is very, very good at her, right? But she has a lot of matchups that are skill matchups, right? So I think one of the things Team Expert is saying here is that we think that our solo laner is very strong, right? Because otherwise, why wouldn't you hold your solo laner for last pick, right?
Right.
This is also a bit of a weird map with the solo lane, right? Because this is one of the only maps that I think it's actually good to lose the solo lane in, right? As long as you don't lose it too hard.
Oh, really?
And the reason being is the map is very small and rotations are very quick, right? Mm-hmm. And you actually have to step up to get gems. And so if the gems die to your towers, right? Mm-hmm. Someone has to step up into tower range on a map with very short rotations to grab the gems, right? Sure. Mm-hmm. And so that's incredibly risky. Mm-hmm. And so losing the solo lane is actually sort of good on this map because you can make your enemy take that risk early on, as long as you don't lose it too hard, right?
Right, you don't want to lose the whole fort.
You don't want to lose the towers, yeah.
And that might be their choice for picking the Sonya up now instead of later, right? Because if you have last pick, you can guarantee yourself a winning matchup, right? But you don't necessarily need to on this match, right? Or this map, right? So they want to see the second damage typing and then match their second healer here, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. I like the Sonya choice too. Go ahead.
I was going to say, I like the choice because it frees up that fifth slot to answer in a more broad way, right? You just said that, yeah, they could have held the pit for the solo lane, but you still need a solo laner. And now you have far more options.
The only thing that makes me kind of lean towards a Leoric here, though, is I really like him on this map for the ultra quick rotations with his E. He's like a solo laner he's always with your middle lane, you know, like he can get there so quickly. So I would like that, but I do think Sonya moves better into the mid game once she starts getting her defensive talents and Wrath of the Berserker. I think she does what Leoric does while also doing way more damage. So they're both good. I might just like Leoric more, but yeah.
I think another consideration to take in mind here is that Leoric would have been a good pick too, because it accomplishes the same thing in the solo lane, right?
Mm-hmm.
But one of the considerations is that, do we want an active solo laner or do we want a passive solo laner, right?
Right.
And they're saying, okay, we got D-Shield, right? So we could D-Shield Mash, or we could also D-Shield Sonya, right?
Right.
Let her go crazy, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that's another consideration, is that they're saying, we think that we're going to have enough resources to let Sonya go crazy and really be the monster that Sonya is, right?
Right.
Because if you don't have the resources to do that, then you can't pick up Sonya, right?
Right.
And then you go Leoric. And Leoric is very strong right now,
yeah,
but he doesn't quite have the team fighting impact, right, that Sonya does.
No, not
right.
at all. Yeah.
Well, the other thing is, I'm not sure that Entombed gets as much value with the comp on the board.
Most Leos are going March now, but yeah.
It's
pretty good, but
I really want to talk about this next pick.
Yeah, let's get to it.
On Team Wish.
So they pick up a Lunara and a Dahaka.
Right, so the Lunara seems like a direct response to the Uther pickup.
Yeah.
But I don't... How do they not know that they're going to go to double support and a lot of that benefit is just to be canceled out? Like, this seems like a little bit of a misstep to me. Can you try to explain to me maybe what they were thinking?
Okay, I think you nailed it on the head here. Mm-hmm. Lunara, direct response to the Uther, right?
Mm-hmm.
They say, okay, we're going to mismatch damage and healing typings, right? Uther has single target burst healing, like Lunara has both single target sustain and multi-target AoE damage, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And I think that's exactly what they were thinking, right? And the reason that they picked this up is because they want to make sure that Team Expert doesn't do anything wonky in this last pick, right?
Okay.
By going the Lunara, you force out the second healer, right? There's a second healer coming for sure as soon as you lock that in, right?
Right.
Yeah. And I think they think that, okay, we got, you know, Lucio, Lunara, right? We can force them out into second healer, right? We'll get a global, maybe get an advantage into the late game, right?
Right.
So they were so afraid of the unknown that they locked him into something they were probably going to do anyway that is already fairly strong.
Right. Well, they were so worried about the ADRD wacky pick that they kind of hurt themselves in a way, because the Lunara is going to have a hard time getting effective damage. But they do have the gray main, but it leaves them with that solo Lucio against Avala. So
it seems very odd.
Yeah.
Yes, and I think it's a bit odd too. I think the Dahaka pick is maybe more what's causing their awkwardness than anything else, though.
So. And do you want to elaborate on that?
So they've strayed away from all of the meta strategies that I talked about before. They're not in the triangle of rock, paper, scissors anymore, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because they have no double support, right? So the 113 and the rat are out. They have no double global either, right?
Right.
So that's sort of out too. So this is a very awkward situation for them because they've strayed away from the meta, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Per se.
This is definitely an off-meta draft. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Well, I don't know if it's off-meta. Like, all the heroes here are relatively
Each
meta,
individual
right?
hero is a meta hero. Yeah, yeah, you're right. But,
but that does not make for a meta comp.
Right, right.
Yeah, it's not necessarily one of the big trilogy strategies, one of the big three trilogy strategies, right?
Right, right.
I think that's where they messed up more than anything else, right? Because we see the Uther coming out from the other team, right?
What would you like that Dahaka to be?
Or I think Lunara. It needs to be a second healer of sorts.
Yeah.
I think that the better way to go about this was, as soon as they saw that Vala, they sort of said, we need single target healing, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then they either pick up Oriole or the Medic, and this is an entirely different game, right?
Right. So unless the Sonya goes leap or something crazy, that medic's relatively safe too.
Yeah, well, the thing about Leap actually on Sonya is it actually only has higher damage for 1 second, right? You get a stun and you get 1 second of just a tad bit more damage, like 100 extra damage or something like that.
Right.
So it, the real threat is a stun there. And the reason you play double support is so that you have one support protect the other in the 1-1-3 composition, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so you would normally take, if you see the Sonya, right? Maybe you get the Uther then, or you get Lucio still, and then you just Sound Barrier when that happens, and you should be able to win off that fight.
Should be okay, yeah.
As long as you don't group up too much, right? As long as both supports don't get hit, you're good, right?
Yeah.
Right.
I don't know. If it was me, though, I would feel very, I'd feel very antsy about the solo Lucio against what they have. Obviously, sometimes solo Lucio I'd be fine with, but against this, I don't know. I would feel like we don't have enough, but. This is where I thought the draft was pretty interesting. So obviously they were going double support all along, and they opt for the Stukov. Now that we've talked about it, it almost feels like Stukov is like, oh, well, thanks for picking Lunara. Here's Stukov, you know?
Well, and for that matter, Greymane when he dives. Like,
right.
I don't know.
So what do you think of the Stukov final pick here? I like it a lot. I think it shores up everything, every strength this draft has, and adds a really nice silence, you know?
Right, that silence, yeah. So good.
So I think that it's good, but I think that an Oriole would actually have been just a tad bit
with
better,
Devala,
right?
Yeah,
so one of my reasoning here is that if we look at the healing throughputs of Oriole and Stukov, right, Oriole, even with her 2 second cooldown nerf,
mm-hmm.
actually outputs about twice as much healing, right?
Right. As long as she has that
and
person to make
hope.
Yeah,
as long as she's getting consistent hope, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which is not so hard to do with the 4 second cooldown these days, right?
No.
But if you look at the raw numbers, Oriole exerts almost twice as much healing as Stukov, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the main reason that you would pick a Stukov over Oriole is you're worried about poke damage, right?
Yeah.
Because Oriole's very weak to poke damage. Stukov, very not weak to poke damage, right?
Right.
Because there's no reason, you can't poke out his hyper carry, right? You can't poke out the hyper carry to the point of they can't trade with you anymore, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, suddenly Oriole gets no healing, right?
Right. So you would have ideally liked an Oriole. The Stukov is flashier, though. He's got more style.
Yeah, but I like the silence, the two. I mean, do you think that they already thought that they were far enough ahead where they could take some of the utility that Stukov brings instead of needing the all that extra healing from Oriole?
I think this comes down to two things. I think that they were worried that the Lunara was gonna... So Lunara with Splintered Spear can actually poke from a decent range. It's far much longer than her actual auto range, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because the spears will sort of just auto-target people. They've been known to fly miles, right? And I think that's one of the things they're looking at. I think the second thing is this is a big preference stuff, because yeah, the silence gives you lots of utility,
mm-hmm.
but there's another thinking to this draft where that Oriole actually gives you a lot more kill pressure, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or as much kill pressure maybe, because ETC slides somebody, Uther stuns them, Q Bill Valet does Q, another Q, right? And then there's either a silence there or a stun into a wall with the Oriole, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that both of them actually bring relatively decent utility, right? Stukov brings slows and silences. Oriole brings wave clear and more like kill pressure, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I guess Stukov brings kill pressure too with his silence, right?
Right.
Well, and so I think there's a lot of merit to both, and that they both fill a very similar niche. And it might just be that the support player who's going to be playing Stukov prefers Stukov.
Right,
mm-hmm. That's a perfectly reasonable explanation there too.
There is one advantage to the Stukov here over the Oriole, and that's the Aegis. The Aegis isn't they. So we talked about the three types of damage, and the type of damage over on the side of Team Wish is sustained. It's not really bursty.
Greymane's kind of bursty,
right? But with Oriole, if he's gonna go for the throat, like if he does it, it's already too late. You can't Aegis go for the throat, you know. You can Aegis him when he's in there and like maybe like dissuade him from doing it, but
you also have Divine Shield too, I guess.
Yeah, and you have Divine Shield. So I think the Aegis would not be, I mean, Aegis is always good, don't get me wrong, it's a great spell. But I think the swipe against this comp would be more effective than the Aegis, especially if Johanna Ironskins at the wrong time. And you get that gust type separation, right? You can isolate that Johanna really easily because she's not going to get swiped. So I think in the ult department in this comp against Team Wish's comp, I kind of like the Stukov, honestly.
Yeah. Well, the Stukov, I think both the Stukov and the Oriole are great. Mm-hmm. And if I'm not mistaken, I believe that the Oriole can actually blind go for the throat and will not do any damage, because I believe it's
13 talent.
Yeah.
Is it though? It's actually 3 auto attacks. I thought it counted as a spell, like a burst spell, even though the animation was swiping.
I'm not 100% sure, but that's something that needs some testing, because I remember it not working at one point.
You might be right. Yeah, I mean, you could be right. Yeah. I thought it was. I thought it was magic damage. Yeah.
Also, there's no reason that you have to go Aegis. I mean, you've been watching any of our games recently, we actually picked up a Resurrect once, right?
Nice. I actually didn't see that. No.
There might be a highlight of that game on Reddit. I think McIntyre flew into the enemy base and whipped somebody into a wall and killed them.
That's awesome.
Nice.
I agree that Stukov is a good pick here, and that being able to isolate the Johanna might actually be something useful for them, right?
Yeah.
So looking at these drafts, you know, to me, it seems like Team Expert kind of cleaned up pretty handily here. Well, you know, as a drafter who does this far more than Danny or I, you know, what do you see once you've looked at these drafts in their kind of final stage?
Okay, so if we just go look back and we say rock, paper, scissors strategies, right? Mm-hmm. I think Team Expert has a rock, paper, scissors strategy here, right? Mm-hmm. They have, I would consider this a variation on the 1-1-3, right? Because when we see the rat, we normally see two ranged, you don't see a solo laner, you see a duo laner. And so you normally see two ranged assassins and two healers, right?
Right.
And so this is like a strange version of the 1-1-3, where you have sort of a mixed matching of supports, right? Mm-hmm. Where you just grab two supports and you say, this is a 1-1-3, right? Yeah. And the Uther does okay, granting some armor to Vala to just make it so that she can trade a little bit safely, right? Got big burst heals behind her. She feels a little bit safer. Yeah. Probably not safe as a Tassadar or a medic behind her, right?
No, but still pretty good.
But pretty decent, right? And so I think that Team Expert has this down. They don't have any major weaknesses in their composition either. They have good wave clear. This map is almost entirely decided by if you have enough wave clear. If you don't have enough wave clear, you're in trouble, right?
Right.
And they just barely make that threshold. So I don't think this is a unlosable game, right? If Team Wish plays this just right, I think that they could actually pull ahead, right? Just by exploiting the fact that they just have slightly better wave, right?
Right.
So I think that this is not as much of the one-sided Team Expert has won this draft, simply because the wave clear differential is there, right? There's a Dahaka, there's a Johanna, right? Versus, you know, who's really good at wave clear on their team, maybe Sonya, right?
She's pretty good, yeah. But even Greymane, like, has great wave clear if he's not, you know, being fought, you know, if he just melees in and swipes, you know, it's done, you know. So, yeah, Team Wish has great wave clear for sure. But I think when it, you know, and you're right, this map does get decided by wave clear a lot, but a lot of times, even with the wave clear, you gotta fight at some point. Like, at some point in the game, unless you're way, like, a talent up, and, like, there's no way, you're gonna have to fight, and I think Team Expert definitely has the advantage in that with this draft.
Yeah, I think that they have a more solid plan looking at their draft, right? I think Team Wish has done a bit of an overreaction with their last maybe two picks, right?
Yeah.
Which has sort of differed from where they practiced, maybe, right? Which puts them at a distance. I would say that this game would be a bit in Team Expert's favor, but not so much so that it was decided during the draft, right?
Right.
Right.
Yeah, so, yeah, that's we always talk about that a lot on here, is that people... It's dangerous to try to be reactive in a draft that way. It can pay off, but it can also really hurt you if you break your plan to be reactive. And I think that might be what happened here.
Or if you have to react too late, right? I mean, then you end up just filling with things to try to mitigate the other team's draft without fleshing out your own comp in a synergistic way.
The way I look at it, right, is that you need to have some win conditions, right? And if you can stop your enemy's win conditions at the same time, you that's fantastic, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah,
And
definitely.
I think that both teams have win conditions there, and I just think that there aren't answers for team experts' win conditions on team wishes side.
Right. So, okay. So we're gonna go into our next game now on Infernal Shrines, and is another team wish game, but it's kind of just inadvertent because I wanted to do a team Liquid draft. Another European team who's drafting I actually really like. They kind of underperformed towards the end of phase two, unfortunately. Kind of relied on some Lost Vikings drafts, which weren't working anymore a bit too much, but I still really like the way they draft a lot of their games. So, Infernal Shrines, Team Liquid. And the first pick, first ban, is going to go to Team Liquid, and they do ban out that ETC. We talked about that. It's just solid, and on Infernal Shrines, he has value here. And then the first ban from Team Wish is going to be Abathur.
Okay, yeah, so this is interesting starting off. Because we see that Team Liquid has the option for ETC, right?
Right, they're
And
first. Yeah.
they decide no, we don't want ETC, right? Which is a little bit weird, right? You'd think that would be one of the things that they would want, right?
What does that
And
tell you specifically?
I think what it mostly screams is that we have a composition that we think is unbeatable in this map.
Right, we have something up our sleeve,
Okay.
We have the hydraulic press composition, right?
yeah.
Does that already put Team Wish at a disadvantage, not knowing what that composition is? Or, what would you think if you saw that? How would you approach your own draft?
Well, I think ETC bans are very common, but for normally from second pick, right? And I think that Team Wish is thinking, okay, Team Liquid likes playing Abathur, right? It's probably their composition that they want to go, right? And it's a standard, right? And it can be very strong on certain maps. I don't think Infernal Shrines is one of
Not
them,
particularly,
but
no.
maybe that's what they're thinking. Maybe they say, okay, Team Liquid has only practiced Abathur, right, for the last 8 months straight or something like that. Which is probably not true, right?
Probably
They
not.
had a reason
But
though, and they didn't want to deal with it. But what's curious about it is always when these ban phases happen like this, it always opens the question you got to ask is, are you really okay with giving them Tassadar? So Tassadar is available and there. So apparently, Team Wish isn't worried about it, and justifiably so because Team Liquid first picks to Haka.
okay, so Tassadar is generally, like I said, Tassadar has two maps that he really shines on, which is Towers of Doom and Tomb of the Spider Queen, right? And he's good on other maps, like this one in particular, because we get good wave clear, good shrine clear, right? But he doesn't quite get as much value because of two things, right? First of all, we have the vision that Tassadar provides is very good on Towers of Doom and on also Tomb of the Spider Queen, right? Because you need to control objectives that are right dead in the center of the map, and also that you have a lot of people split up all the time, right? Not so much on Infernal Shrines, where people are less so split up, right? And so you get less value out of the vision, because the vision lets you know when rotations are coming. If you see that many people are coming down on Towers of Doom to the bottom shrine, maybe you can get the top two, right? And it lets you find opportunities a little bit better on those maps in particular, right? Especially on Tomb of the Spider Queen, where you can watch the turn-ins, right? You can get really long range on Tassadar from his level 7 talent to interrupt objectives on both of those maps too. And that's why he is so overpowering on those two maps. And he doesn't get really either of those strengths on this map, because you're not interrupting objective by storming on the, I think it's, on the shrine, right? Because you get a few kills, but you don't get the objective. You don't stop the objective, right? And the vision is less important here. And vision's always important, but oftentimes you know what your enemy's doing, right? If there's an objective up and it's relatively even, they're probably going to come as five, right?
It's and that is a good point with the Tassadar. It's when this objective is very it's very like, I mean, you will have teams that send one person to the shrine, but it's only when they've already killed everyone else on the team, and they want to go soak. So yeah, you don't need that intel as much. I get that.
But he does enable other comps though, right? I mean, he's not there are other reasons to pick him up other than those mentioned, right. those reasons well, you just mentioned.
They first yeah, picked they're... Haka, so they probably want to do the double global, I would assume. But, yeah, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Well, normally the reason we see a double global is because somebody picking a global leads to a global race, and then whoever gets the double global wins. And that's why double global has evolved as one of the meta strategies, because somebody picked one global one time, and then somebody else said, okay, let's counter it by picking up two, right? And yeah, and so by having two globals, you keep yourself safe from you're going to be picking up a single global, right? So as I say, Team Wish picks up like a global here, like Illidan, right? They say, okay, Illidan can just kill the Hawk in the late game. He can never step out because he'll just get haunted, right, and die. Mm-hmm. And Team Liquid says, okay, well, hunt my Dahaka, right? And I'll send a Falsted after you, right?
Right.
And suddenly you get this little skirmish of, okay, well, now Illidan can never go up, because if Illidan, like, steps up and tries to clear a wave, tries to split soak, right? We get both Dahaka and Falsted coming at him, right?
Right.
And okay. So it's just the threat of having double globals is the reason why you take double global, because it punishes somebody for trying to take a single global to punish you.
Right.
And Illidan is generally that single global because he's known as the global killer.
Global killer.
That was a lot of times I said global there.
Yeah, you just said the word global like many times, but that's okay because, you know, globals have been a big deal in this game for years now. Years, yeah. So, okay, so there's the Dahaka first pick going into what we were just discussing about the global race. But let's see if Team Wish wants to play that game. It looks like they don't because they pick up an Uther and a Genji.
Nice little combo in its own right.
Yep.
So I looked at this before the game and I was like, that's an interesting response, right? Because you guys had linked me the games beforehand that we were going to look at.
Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. I have a little tool that I use, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, why did they do this, right? And after using my tool, I still don't know. Because I looked at... I have a tool that looks at all of the games and I can say, okay, one team has the Haka, the other team has Genji, right?
Right.
What is the win rate like between these two, right?
Mm-hmm.
The Haka versus Genji, on this map, it was an absolute wash. It was 50-50, right? Okay. And the Haka versus Genji in general has a win rate of 47.4% over like 170 games. We're starting to get some better data there, right?
Right.
And so... I don't know why they've responded like this, right?
Right.
Because it doesn't seem statistically valid, right? It's you're picking up a pseudo global to deal with a real global, right?
Right.
I'm not exactly sure what they're thinking.
But I think it was probably just a matter of this isn't that like Ryan said right away. It's just these two heroes go well together, and we like them kind of probably, you know, like we just like Uther Genji. We think it's a good combo, and also Uther is a soft counter to Genji, so you know we don't have to worry about him getting stun locked out.
Right.
So they probably just wanted it. I don't know if it was trying to play the global game, you know?
Yeah, maybe they said, screw rock, paper, scissors, right? We're drafting this comp game, right?
Right, right. We're doing this comp, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Which, you know, works a lot of the time, but we'll see here. Going into the next phase, we do have a Rhaegar from the Team Liquid and...
Big fan of that.
A Nubarak. Yeah, I like the Rhaegar pickup a lot. Just especially... I think he's better than Uther right now, unless you have a real strong reason to have Uther. And then, he can take camps. He's got a little damage. He's considered really, really strong right now. And then the Anubarak, I find the Anubarak part more interesting. What do you think of that pickup? What do you think they're trying to dissuade with that Anubarak pick? Or are they just trying to chain CCs?
So the first thing that comes to mind is that Cocoon is going to try to go on D-Blade.
Right.
And I think this might have been a bit of a misstep, right?
Right. It seems weird, yeah.
Cocoon can't go on D-Shield D-Blade, right?
Right, right, right. It's like, exactly, yeah.
It doesn't quite work that way, right?
Heroes 101.
But maybe they're thinking, I believe this game was a little while ago, right?
Yeah.
It's the end of September.
Mm-hmm.
End of September, okay.
Yeah, this is the last time they played in Europe, so...
So this was back when Nubarak was a big deal. He was an OP, right?
Right.
He's the go-to tank, right? Mm-hmm. And this might be partially a denial pick and partially like, okay, we got Cocoon for D-Blade, right?
Yeah.
And if we can't get Cocoon D-Blade, maybe we could like get the Uther before he D-Shields it, right?
Right. That's what I was thinking.
Or any future pick, too, right? I mean, Yeah, there's lots of other things he proactively discourages.
Yeah, I think it was just kind of like a cocoon Uther, start the fight. That's the plan, you know.
Well, I actually had a fascinating thought today. In Hero League, right? I was playing some Hero League, and my team had I was playing Lee Ming on my team, right? And the enemy in Nubarak, they had enemy in Nubarak and enemy Genji, and I thought this was really awesome, right? Because a good counter to a Nubarak's cocoon is disintegrate, right?
Right, absolutely.
And when I was playing today, I go, oh my gosh, they have a Genji, right? What if the Anubarak cocoons somebody and Genji stands on top of it and deflects when I try to disintegrate, right?
Oh, okay.
And so I've always thought of that as, like, that's a little bit of a tangent, but, like,
did it happen?
It didn't happen. Oh. I was thinking about it the entire game. I'm like, oh my gosh, there's no way they could actually be thinking that, right?
Right. I mean, it would probably be pretty good. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think disintegrate hits something like 32 times a second, right?
Right. So whoever's near him would definitely be feeling it. Yeah. That'd be cool to see.
Yeah. Okay. But that was my crazy thought that I had today.
Yeah, no worries. No worries. So
you
think they just picked up the Anubarak here because he was more in the meta at the time and Cocoon was just considered good all the time, sort of thing?
And I think they also didn't want it on the other side.
Right.
Yeah,
they didn't want to have to waste a ban on banning a Anubarak, because a Anubarak with a Genji and an Uther, suddenly you have a super dive team, right?
Right.
Nice Stunlock. Yeah.
Stunlock dive team, yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. Okay, so going to the second ban phase, unless there's something you wanted to add about Rhaegar.
Well, I actually think that the Rhaegar pick is incorrect here, too.
Okay,
right?
let's hear it.
So, you want to, there's two things you want to do in the draft, right? And one of them is create your own win conditions, and one of them is deny enemy win conditions, right? And I think they already have their own win condition on the table with the Dahaka global value, right? Dahaka gets global value, right? Comes into the fight, makes uneven fights, right? That's how we win this game, right?
Yeah.
And I think that a better pick for them would have been something to try to deny the enemy win condition, right? And so maybe last game Lucio wasn't a great pick, but I think Sound Barrier is an excellent response to Dragonblade, right?
Yeah.
Another good response actually might have been a Tranquility Malfurion, right?
Oh, really?
You have big AoE damage coming out from the Dragonblade. You have big AoE healing coming out from the Tranquility, right? That being said, Lucio's Amp It Up actually heals for more than Tranquility.
More than Tranquility,
yeah. Tranquility heals longer,
that's
right?
That's a problem.
Yeah, that's the problem. It's real slow, yeah.
So is there any reason why they can't pick up Lucio later, though?
No, there isn't, except for that it might get banned.
Right.
That's true.
Okay.
That's true.
Yeah, so I see what you're saying there for sure. Again, talking into that thing you were kind of emphasizing about types of damage and types of healing. So, yeah, I see it for sure. But they didn't do that. Instead, we're going to go into the bans, and there is the Lucio ban. So Team Wish is able to identify that problem and take care of it, you know, which is cool. You always like to see a smart ban like that. And then Team Liquid bans the Amalthiel.
I have a quick question here. So let's assume that the Lucio hadn't been banned and Team Liquid picked it up. What other choices would they have had for their damage, for their single damage with two healers like that? What would you have picked?
So on which side? Or
if you were Team Liquid and you were able to pick up the Lucio, so now you have Dahaka, Rhaegar,
what hyper carry do you want if you get that Lucio?
Yeah. Oh, with the Lucio.
Yeah.
Okay, so I guess what I'm looking at is that there's two different ways to play this, right? You can either have, we go back to the meta strategies again, we have a 1-1-3 or we have the wrap, right? And either way, we're gonna need a range damage, right?
Yeah.
And then we need a range damage, needs to be an auto attack damage. I probably want it to be either a sustained single target or a sustained multi-target damage, right? To deal with the Uther, right? So that I can mix match, right? And then that's when I start narrowing it down, right? Okay, so we have multi-target damage, right? We could go into a Lunara potentially, right? Avala is always good, right? But I think one of the things I would be thinking about if I had Lucio and I had Rhaegar would be maybe I want something that's a little bit less squishy, right?
Right.
And so you can also opt in for a variety of hyper carries that are less squishy, Like Gul'dan is less squishy. He's 1900 health from level one,
And a
right?
lot of self-heal.
Yeah, he has self-heal. He has eat minions, right?
Right.
He has got fear to keep him safe until he gets cleansed, right?
Yeah. I think people would be worried that's not enough burst though.
Right.
Yeah, you would have to out sustain, and then you would be playing the okay, well, we have, Lucio to run away and to give a sound barrier if we get jumped on, and maybe we have both the Rengar and the Dahaka split, right? Until we win the game through getting levels up, right? And we win the game through getting level 16 Gul'dan and, levels.
Right.
Okay. So we're back to our traditional hyper carries plus a couple that you may not
Yeah,
typically
you're back to
consider.
traditional hyper carries or also ranged assassins that are a little bit safer, right?
Yeah. Okay.
So we're talking Lunara. Greymane is pretty iffy in this situation, but
Yeah,
there
you don't
are
have any
a variety of
burst
hyper
heal.
carries.
Okay.
What? There's
Chuck,
a
so
variety
you
of
don't
them.
have the burst heal other than the Lucio sound barrier, which you kind of need to deal with Dragon Blade, right? So.
Yeah, you need the dragon. You need the sound barrier to deal with. Specifically, Dragon Shield, Dragon Blade, or the Divine Shield? Divine Shield, Dragon Blade.
Right.
No Dragon Shields here.
Dragon Shield, yeah. The
We should call it that now. I like
yeah,
that in that
that's yeah.
combo. Yeah.
Yeah.
Dragon Shield.
The Asia would straight rip the Sergeant Hammer here. Honestly. Like they would if they picked up that Lucio, they'd draft a hammer, some of those teams. And it actually would be all right. A lot they know how to make hammer work over there. So that's an option. I'd like to see NA maybe dabble in some of those, like a Gul'dan hyper carry, like you said, or a hammer like that. Yeah, but
I think Lunara would also be
Lunara,
pretty solid here.
yeah.
She have enough damage by herself?
I think the worry is not having. I don't think there's a concern about not having enough damage in this composition because you have the global, right? And you eventually get ahead of levels, and then levels will snowball you, right?
Okay.
And so, like, you can when you get levels ahead, you're gonna poke them out, and that's especially relevant in the double support comps. Because you have long sustained fights, right? Where a one level advantage is not only 4% on average, 4% health, it's also 4% damage, right? And so if you get a couple levels ahead, say you're like three, we'll call it, okay, two levels ahead, right? You have 8% health, 8% damage on every single hero on your team, right? Suddenly if that starts to add up, that's like almost a half of an extra player, right?
Right. That's true.
And you end up just being far enough ahead that having a composition that you might traditionally regard as low damage is not so low in damage anymore, right?
That's just not something I consider enough in my own games, I think.
Yeah, I think we've kind of been trained to just look at talent tiers, rather
Yeah.
than levels. But levels are a factor. You feel it when you're losing by 4 or 5 levels. You're like,
In
wait a
which case,
minute, I'm supposed to win that trade, but they're 4 levels
yeah.
up and I didn't. Yeah. But other than
Right.
that, you don't really notice it, but it is definitely there. Yeah.
Well, if you want to think of it in terms of talent tiers, I had one person who was writing a guide for me the other day say it really well, is that if you're going to take a talent like Executioner, consider how many levels of extra damage that would be, right? That's like 30% extra damage or 7 extra levels,
Seven
right?
levels up,
Right.
Yeah.
I mean,
Which is
talents are the
significant.
be all end all of power spikes over the other team, yeah. But
Yeah.
you can't forget that levels are still something, just a straight
Right.
level,
Yeah. And I think the
Especially when you're
level
playing a comp like that, that has to exploit that
slow fight,
specifically, right?
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think slow damage in particular, slow damage, slow healing, you use your abilities a lot of times, right?
Right.
And that's where the levels start to get really snowbally. And I think that maybe that's one of the reasons why it's not so fun for some viewers to watch double support meta, is because when a team gets ahead with double support, they're very likely going to stay ahead, right? Because just the level lead alone, despite talents, can snowball them very well.
Yeah. Well, that's all. Yeah, it's something to look at and think about when you're looking at the speed of fights. We talk about that a lot on here. Or people come on here and talk about it is your objective with your comp is to win a fight at a certain speed or prolong a fight a certain amount. So yeah, definitely a factor. The
And
levels.
that's
Yeah,
the
and that's the Lucio ban, right?
Lucio
So
ban.
Team Wish now. With the smart Lucio ban, picks up the Greymane and the Diablo. I actually like the Diablo choice myself. You don't see
Well,
him a
was there
lot.
anything specific about the Malthiel we should pay attention
Oh, I'm
to,
sorry, I
or
forgot the Malthiel, yeah.
Okay. I think the most relevant part of the Mayfield ban is that I actually think it's a rather good ban. Because Team Liquid, if they don't necessarily have to go into double support, right? But if they get jumped on with a massive AoE damage and they do not have double support, right, they're gonna be in a
I
bad
mean, they
position.
have two warriors and a melee healer. Yeah. So
Yeah, they're gonna
Tormented
be.
Souls is, yeah.
Yeah, and if they don't opt for a second healer, right, that's gonna be a disaster for them, right? To have both Dragonblade, D-Shield, and Tormented Souls on top of them, right?
Right.
With
That's
maybe an Uther heal even, right?
too much.
That's
Yeah.
gonna be an absolute chaos and horrible for them. And also Mayfield beats to the Hakka in lane, right? And it'll just be brutal. And the second thing I see is even if they go into the second healer, right? Well, Mayfield's really good against double healer comps because he has, I think it's called Touch of Death at 4,
Right.
50% healing reduction
Yeah.
on everything when he Tormented Souls, right?
Or
And
everything, is it
so
everything
that's
he Tormented
significant
Souls?
value there. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's doubly brutal
It
against them,
it's
right?
everything that's marked, right?
Yeah, everything
Yeah.
that's marked.
Okay, yeah. Yeah. So
It's
yeah,
less
good.
than 4 seconds.
Yeah, good ban for sure. So Gray Main Diablo. Diablo, as long as the enemy team doesn't have a very effective way of entering the shrine, makes it scary to enter the shrine and contest it. Obviously, Burrow Charge is a pretty good choice, but other than that, if it's hard to walk into the shrine because he has those four corners to slam into, you know. So I like that choice. I don't see anything on Team Liquid's team that's too scary to Diablo right now, and of course, Gray Mane has great shrine clear and just is a solid hero for lane
And
entry.
another target for D Shield.
Yeah, Divine Shield target. Yeah.
I think in addition to that, there's a lot more merit to Diablo than meets the eye, right? Because when we think about heroes that deal with Diablo, or if you guys want to name a few that deal with Diablo pretty well,
Leoric,
Leoric, okay,
I guess,
probably not going to get picked up, right?
yeah, Karazim, seven-sided,
Karazim, Rayman.
Garrosh gets countered by Diablo, so no, not that.
The two that I think of the most and the two that Team Liquid would need in this position, I think, are Greymane and Fallah, right?
Greymane, yeah, Greymane destroys
Greymane's
him,
picked
yeah.
up, yeah.
Yeah, Greymane's already picked up. Valhalla, right? Later in the game, you get Manticore. You can just poke the Diablo
Right.
forever and forever. But Diablo poses a huge threat to Valhalla, right? In
Yes.
addition, you have a Dragonblade Divine Shield,
Dragon
right?
Shield.
And a Greymane coming straight for the Valhalla, right? And so
That's a scary
Valhalla
pick.
is no longer a real viable counter here, because if you try to like poke out the Diablo, try to do damage to the Diablo, he's just gonna charge you with no regrets, right? And you'll probably just die because Valhalla's one of the squishy heroes in the game, right? 1200 health, right? Compare that to like Stitch's 3000 health, right? And Genji's dash alone does 200 damage, right?
You're right. There's a lot of value in the Diablo here. Not only does he bring his own utility, but he also shuts down an avenue for Team Liquid's remaining
Yeah,
draft
I think,
slots, right? So.
yeah, it's also a good map for him, right? We talked about how he can charge people into the four corners, right, of all the shrines. And there's lots of minions on him, this map for him. And finally, right, I think that what Team Wish is getting at here is what I like to call a chaos composition, right? Where you just throw stuff at them. Be it AoE damage that they have to deal with, right? People diving in, right? This is a chaos composition, right? And so APOC serves that really well, right? And if they had a Mayfield behind that as their last pick, this chaos composition would have been brutal, right?
Yeah,
You
oh my
think,
God,
yeah.
that's terrifying. Yeah. But yeah, so I guess we're all on the same page then that Diablo is really strong here in this draft, and sometimes I see a lot of drafts, and maybe it's because I play a lot of Diablo, but I see a lot of drafts even in HGC where I'm like, that's the perfect spot for Diablo, and they just don't even consider him, you know. So I do like it here. Like you'll see Diablo when somebody's, you know, playing Medivh, and it's like, oh, he came out of the portal, yeah, you know, like yeah, and it's cool and it's effective. Don't get me wrong, but that's like you should. I feel like you should see him more, you know.
Well, I think actually a great counter with a Medivh might be Diablo. Because suddenly there's no Lombo combo there,
Right.
right?
Yeah, that's true.
And also, if somebody walks through a portal, you can sort of scoot them away a little bit, which is nice.
Yeah, they can push
And
them off.
also, APOC against Apoc leaves 5 circles on the ground, and Medivh's got 1 shield. So I think that's also, you know, a good starting place to look at. Maybe the Diablo's a good counter to the Medivh, in addition to being a good synergy with the Medivh, right?
Right, right. Totally. Right.
So what type of comps do well against the Taos comp you were talking about? What are the tools you need in order to deal with that? I mean, what immediately comes to mind is Sound Barrier, but
Sound Barrier is a great start to that.
What else, you know, if you see this coming at you in a draft, what are the things you would ideally like to have to deal with it that maybe make it easier to deal with other than, you know, just
what
you draft?
I think Chaos comps are really good at one thing, and that's fighting, right?
Mm-hmm. Right. It's the old Nomantic style comp, you know? Yeah.
And my first thought would be, let's not fight them, right? that would be my first thought. Let's try to just not fight them, right? And I think Team Liquid's got the right idea here, right? Yeah. They have a global going for them, right? Mm-hmm. And if they never have to fight 5v5 because they have a global advantage, right? That's a great start to the Chaos comp. They also have a new Barak, which can shut down. Like, maybe it shuts down the gray main, maybe it shuts down the last pick, right? So I actually think that Team Liquid's not in a terrible spot, right? Because if they just continue along the path of maybe I would probably grab a second global, like Falsehead Gust, that would be pretty nice, right?
The disengage,
and I think I would just continue down the same path that I'm going as Team Liquid, right? Mm-hmm. And maybe not opt for the second support, right?
Okay,
and maybe just opt for a second global instead of that, right?
Right, which is dead.
And that's
they definitely can't
quite
do
what they
it.
Do.
Yeah, this is where I found the draft interesting. Once again, we saw a rare pick in Acacia, and the Karazim as the second support. So let's look at this here. Cassia's Karazim. Obviously, Cassia is nice against Grey Main. There's no doubting that. Other than that, though, I'm not sure why she was picked up. Do you have any thoughts on that?
So my guess is this, we need a ranged assassin that's not going to die so quickly, right?
Right.
And there's a bunch that come to mind, right? Against a single Genji, right? Li Ming's pretty good because you get force armor and you can live despite having a low health pool, right, into the D-Blade. But it's not very good against Greymane, right? So who else do we have? Greymane's off the table because he's picked, right?
Right.
There's Lunara, but Cassie has a bigger health pool, and she also has 65 armor when she's moving. Mm-hmm. And we're sort of running out of heroes here. You got Nazebo, you have Tychus, and...
Rainer?
You have Gul'dan. Rainer's just too squishy, he would die, right?
Yeah.
But I'm looking at like the high health ranged assassins, right?
Right.
And the ones that come to mind are Tychus, right? Mm-hmm. Which is, I think it might have been their best pick.
I think Tychus is the right choice here against that Genji, because that's traditionally what you think of Tychus for, as being for. It hasn't happened in a while, but that was the thing for a while. It's like you pick Tychus against Genji because he can protect himself, you know?
But when you've gotten a significant amount of value from Horrify on a Gul'dan?
Probably not. You would have gotten... You might have been... Like, I don't... think you could have reliably fear enough people away or in, because Chaos comp means people are everywhere, right?
Right.
But a lot of it requires dive here too, right? You know, the Diablo diving in, Leoric's melee, so he's got to be in there. Greymane's gonna dive.
But Diablo is diving on you as Gul'dan.
Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah.
And like, you don't want to fear him into you. You want to, and who would you want to fear into you? Would it be Greymane with a D shield? I'm not sure, right?
Hopefully nobody with a D shield, really, right?
But whoever gets feared is gonna get a D shield or a cleanse, right?
In my scenario, Uther's web wrapped, so
that's
true. Yeah, there you go.
Then,
you guys are playing a HGC game in your minds, man.
That's right.
But considering yourself the only damage is Gul'dan, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's hard to kill Greymane. He's got 1900 health, and if he's in wolf form, 10 armor chain, right?
Right.
Genji, you might be able to kill. If you hit a nice spear on Genji, that's probably a kill, right?
Yeah.
Unless he just dashes out afterwards, right?
Yeah, the
price. Risky, but possible, right? And then the last pick, who knows what it is yet, right?
I think there are better choices here, though. Like,
than the Cassia, I think so.
Because she's A. You want to pick her when she gets a lot of value. You're like, oh, you pick 2 auto attackers, you know, like that sort of thing. Or The other thing to consider here is she's not actually ranged. Like, I know she's ranged, but she's not ranged. Like, she's a pretty much, she's like a little bit above a melee range.
Yeah,
you know?
She has 4.5 range, and the normal range on ranged assassins is 5.5, right?
Oh, is it really only one? It feels like so much less. Like,
it's really only one, yeah.
Huh.
But
it's just a fend,
the
right?
Thing about, yeah. The thing about one is that I'm not exactly sure how long melee range is, but it might be more than zero.
It is more than zero, yeah, because like,
yeah,
yeah, you can
melee hit, range might be like two, right?
Yeah, you can hit with some space.
That's a pretty,
yeah,
big jump,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, you're probably right. So yeah, that's the other thing is like she just doesn't feel safe against this comp to me.
No, yeah, she doesn't. And I think that between Cocktail and Genji's actually mostly ability damage,
yeah,
right? And Diablo Shadow Charging you into a wall, that's
right.
That's ability damage.
That's
right?
Game over, right?
Like, I think the only thing that really, the damage that it stops is like maybe some of the Grey Mane's auto attacks, right?
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, it would. That's about it.
Yeah. I think that, yeah, maybe it was like we'll try to punish people for going on somebody else, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not sure if that was good logic either, because the Chaos comp is generally rather split, right? With the Genji being on one side, maybe the Diablo and the Grey Mane are together, right? But Splash maybe doesn't get that much damage, right?
Mm-hmm. They might have seen it as an opportunity to blind the Grey Mane when he dives, and then it is a melee heavy composition, so they thought maybe they'd get a lot of value out of Lightning Ball Lightning, possibly.
Yeah, and maybe like the level 7 that everyone is called Surge of Light,
yeah.
Yeah, the one hits everyone. Maybe they're thinking that too.
I don't know, but it seems like there's just a better choice here, you know? Like, it really does.
Yeah.
Like, I'd even put a mage here. You know, obviously, ideally, you want an auto attacker, but if, like, it's slim pickings, I don't know. You could play Chromie or something, or Li Ming. I don't know.
Yeah, and it depends if you're going to still commit to the second support.
Right, that's what I wouldn't take Karazim then, that's for sure. That's another pick here that puzzles me, is the Karazim. I'm not sure what he's bringing to the table that a different support wouldn't. You know, I guess more damage.
Well, what I think of when I see Karazim is I think, okay, most people go Iron Fist, right?
Right.
And so Iron Fist means you're sort of like a backline diver,
right?
Right.
Right.
And I'm confused as to why
melee comp.
Backline diver. Melee comp, right?
Yeah.
It's odd,
yeah.
Yeah, it's definitely a bit odd.
See, I would have considered like Brightwing here,
yeah,
if I was going to go second support.
Especially at this patch, Brightwing was really good. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of utility, and you just second heal.
Well, that leads me into something that actually sort of I talked about a bit of this before.
Mm-hmm.
If either of you guys have seen my recent blog post about our, I called it like the Chronicle, the Crucible, or something like that, right?
And how we lost Heroes Hearth, yeah.
And how we lost the imported support specifically, right?
Mm-hmm.
I referred to their composition as a unicorn composition, right?
Mm-hmm.
And let me tell you exactly why today. I'll let you in on the secret sauce here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so say we keep all of these picks on Team Liquid the same, except for we change out the Karazim for a Brightwing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now real quick, back to our rock, paper, scissors, we got three different three different main strategies in the meta. What strategy are we running, right?
Mm-hmm.
If we go the Brightwing,
double global.
Dang. Okay,
right, is that wrong?
That's not wrong, right?
Yeah,
but are we running anything else?
One I don't know, are we?
You got the hyper carry and the two supports.
Oh,
right?
yeah that's true.
1-3-1.
So you're double support and double global. Yeah,
we have actually two different strengths in our composition, right?
Mm-hmm.
If we do that. And that's where I think that the Brightwing could have been a fantastic pick, right?
Mm-hmm.
And because if Team Wish is beating you when you're trying to play to one strength, why not just play to the other, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Are they going to have answers for both? Probably not, right?
Right.
And that's where Heroes Hearth got tripped up against imported support, because they ran compositions that featured Brightwing, right? Brightwing is a global support, which means you can run unicorn style compositions with her.
Right. She's the only one.
Multiple meta, right? Because if you try to play a meta composition against a unicorn composition, the unicorn composition always wins because they just play to their strengths.
It's
right?
Rock and scissors, yeah.
They play rock and scissors, and then it doesn't matter what you are, but you're going to lose, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Huh. Hmm. And that's where we got tripped up in the playoffs before Crucible.
Right. So what do you do about that? What do you do about the I guess, do you feel a bright wing comps are really that strong now, and what can you do about it, I guess?
They're only strong until people adapt, right?
Right.
And if you look how my team dealt with it in specifically the playoffs, day three, right?
Mm-hmm.
We say, okay, well, throw the meta out the window, right? If we want to play into the Brightwing.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're not going to play rock, paper, or scissors, right?
Mm-hmm.
If we're going to play into Brightwing, we cannot play rock, paper, scissors because they're all going to lose, right?
Right.
Right.
So we have two options, right? We either draft a unicorn cop of our own featuring some other hero, right? Or just ban it out, right?
Right. Or ban.
And that's so because we had short time, we just banned it out, right?
Mm-hmm. I think and that's always the smartest option, honestly.
We have it prepared a different way. Well, yeah.
Yeah, well, we don't want to ever have to waste a ban just because you can't deal with something, right?
Right, that's true.
And so, because it was like, you know, one day until our next game, we're just like, okay, well, we figured out that it's a unicorn composition, right? We're just going to ban out the unicorn. It's the only thing that imported support has been playing, right, against us. And as long as they don't have their unicorn composition, we can win, right?
Right.
Because we're not going to lose draft by a metric mile, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that if they picked up the Red Wing here, they would have an incredibly strong composition, despite having the Tychus or no Tychus, right? Right. Tychus or Cassia.
Right.
Because they would be able to play either of those strengths.
Yeah. I think you're right. But that is not what happened. In fact, they went with the Karazim, which I just don't get. And then a Leoric on the side of Team Wish. So I think that's just about needing a solo laner more than anything. What do you think of the Leoric pick?
Yeah, I think looking at our framework, we got tank, healer, ranged damage, and I'd consider Crayman a ranged damage. He's got a ranged auto attack,
mm-hmm.
right? Sometimes.
Right. Oh, by the way, sorry, real quick. I should shout out my boy Ryan for calling the Brightwing there. yeah, because the coach of an HGC team was like, that's right, A+ to gold star to you, buddy. So, yeah.
Yes, thank you. Gold stars all around.
Mm-hmm.
It's not often I nail one, so thank you.
Yeah, there you go. Mm-hmm. So yeah, Leoric for the solo wave clear. So couple and Team Liquid did lose this game. And I think it was because of the Cassia and the Karazim. Again, yeah. We have two drafts here where the last two picks are kind of weird, you know, kind of like head scratchers.
Exactly the same place in the draft, actually.
Yeah, exact same place in the draft. The last two picks on the blue team, on the left team. So when you look at this draft as a whole piece, what stands out to you as problems or strengths?
I think the first problem was the Rhaegar pick.
Okay.
The Rhaegar pick didn't bring them much, and it didn't deny the enemy team much, right?
Sure.
There's no win condition solution in there, right? It doesn't bring a win condition. It doesn't remove a win condition, right?
Mm-hmm.
Did the Uther Genji give you enough information to want to auto snap the Lucio though?
Absolutely. Pretty much anytime you see one of these ultimates that goes in does massive AOE damage, it's reasonable to take
the healer
that counters that, right? Yeah.
Okay.
Pretty much as soon as you see one damage, you can take a healer, right? You see another damage, you can take another healer, right? And so when you see that first damage comes out, it's immediately reasonable to take a healer that counters that specific type of damage, right?
Right.
Okay.
And that's why I think that leaving the last, in the other draft that we looked at, they left their final healer pick, right?
Mm-hmm.
They decided to take the soul and say, okay, well, we don't care if our soul winner gets countered, right? It's Sonya, and most times it's a skill matchup anyway, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's Tomb.
It's Tomb, right, exactly. And we'll wait on the healer, and then we will counterpick whatever damage you take with a healer, right?
Right.
And that's what they decided to do in that game, and that was a very smart move, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that when one person commits the damage, another person can commit to a healer, right?
Yeah.
And okay. So maybe committing to... I don't want to say committing to healers early is wrong, right? But you're showing a strategy, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
By committing to a healer early.
What with the Lucio band out here, what support do you take in that slot instead of Karazim?
Brightwing.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Right. I already forgot. Yeah. Sorry. So I'm the opposite of Ryan. I'm the dunce. He's the star student. Yeah, that's right. I'm sorry. I forgot all
about
that.
You're both stars in my heart.
Oh, well, thank you. That's thank actually, you. Like, thank you. That actually like, makes me feel a lot better about my dunce cap.
I'm all warm and fuzzy inside now.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so Team Liquid did drop this game. The Cassia pick being odd, and the Karazhan pick being kind of, and the Rhaegar, like none of their, they have three picks here who don't steal anything away from the enemy comp, right? Or bolster.
And they don't give anything also, right. This is the thing. Because stealing stuff away would be countering, right? And then giving yourself right. would be synergizing, right?
Right.
And if you need to be able to do both when you draft, right? Mm-hmm. And this is like where the big problem of, it's risky to just counter, right? Risky to counter. Because
yes.
if you don't build your own win conditions in, well, you just slowly right. lose because you know you deny the enemy their win condition right. over and over
right.
over again.
You've got right. four heroes that counter theirs and no way to kill or win the game, right? Yeah.
And they just built synergy just while you were building single counters, right? I mean, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's why I guess if there is any advice for open teams, it's build around your synergies, ignore what your opponent is drafting, right?
Mm-hmm.
Give yourself win conditions every single game, worry about the rest, you know, later when you have more time to draft, focus on your play, focus on making sure you have win conditions and playing to those win conditions.
Do you think this game's ready for three drafts or three bans, I mean?
No, I don't think so. I don't think
it's necessary.
Yeah, I think that there are a lot of places where there are heroes with little niches
mm-hmm.
that if you had three bans, that they would get banned out and have unbeatable compositions, right?
Right.
And so, like, an example would be there's not so many globals. We saw the other game that there's not so many single target burst healers, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of little niches like that where there are not quite enough heroes. So I don't think that we're ready for three bans yet because there would, if that happened, we would get unbeatable compositions.
Right. And that's the fear with the multi-ban system, right? And but a lot of people are calling for it in the community. Think that we should have three bans. I tend to agree because like you watch like a League of Legends tournament and they have like whatever, they have like 27 bans on each team and you're like, I don't know what's going on anymore. But I feel like with only 71 heroes, you do enable, with three bans you would enable the ability to have perfect, you know, perfect comps. Which there's gameplay should always be a factor. A team yes. should always have a chance of winning through their gameplay. And I think with three bans, I think you're right. It would be impossible in
it
some
removes
cases.
Too much counterplay to things mm-hmm. that there is currently.
Yeah.
There's only so many heroes with clans, right? There's only so many heroes that stop burst damage. Only so many globals, right?
Yeah.
And by being able to ban out, so say globals counter your strategy, you ban out all the good globals, right? The heroes that are balance like good enough that you can play them in competitive, right? Mm-hmm. Which is a wide variety of heroes. I'd probably argue that you could probably play maybe all except for 10 or 20 heroes in competitive, right?
Yeah.
What do you think is the absolute worst hero in the game right now?
Hold on, let me pull up my tier list.
He's a numbers guy. Right. Yeah, you know that.
Let me pull up my tier list. I have a list of heroes organized by tiers, and I'm gonna go find the one in my lowest tier.
Yeah.
It's the worst.
The disdain.
Give me just
tier.
A second.
We should start asking this more, Danny.
Yeah,
it probably says a lot.
Well, who do you think it is, Ryan? While he looks, we'll say ours.
Oh, you go first.
You go first. I think the worst hero in the game. It's kind of a hard question, man.
I know. That's why I needed you to go first. I wasn't prepared to answer my own question.
I think it's Gazlo or Raynor.
Raynor was where my mind first went.
Raynor can win, though, and so can Gazlo. But, like, I don't know. It's tough to say. Anyways, do you find your tier list?
So, yeah, I know you guys really love this hero, and you want to see him played more or her played more. But I think Sergeant Hammer is actually really weak.
Oh, okay.
So my reasoning is that Sergeant Hammer, when you think of what she brings to the table, right, you think of auto attack damage, single target auto attack damage, mm-hmm. right, and also survivable. She's right. rather survivable,
yeah.
right? But the problem is that her auto attack damage is actually a lot lower than you might expect, mm-hmm. even with all her talents. she just doesn't get up to the level of other auto attack carries. And so I think that she has like despite her range, which makes her immobile, right? I think that she doesn't have good wave clear. She doesn't bring great utility, and I think her main strength, her auto attacks, is actually quite weak, right? Compared to like some other heroes, like if you see how much hard Zul'jin hits for these days, right? Or just Vala auto attacks, right? These heroes have a lot more DPS, and they fill a similar niche, right? And so I think that's why I'm gonna put down Sergeant
You
Hammer
say
as my
Hammer.
weakest, because
Okay.
it's just heroes that are, I think, flat out better, right?
Yeah, the thing is, she has to have a comp built around letting her do what she needs to do, which you see in China and Korea, and it's comps that she needs a long time, basically. She needs to be there a long time and shoot for a long time from a safe position, protected. And you need time to do that. And obviously there's a lot of cases where a team fight is going to happen and she's not exactly who you want above all others in your corner during that team fight, you know.
And the one thing she has going for her is her range, right? And I think it's very hard to work around that range to make it to a point where it's really useful, right? Especially with a lot of the power creep we see. We see dash abilities like Genji's going miles and miles. We see Kromi shooting from across the map.
Yeah.
Even Tyrande owls, right?
I'd say
That's
she was
true.
a lot better before some of the newer heroes, yeah, and reworks for
Yeah.
sure.
And that's why I think that she falls close, if not dead bottom, on my list of heroes.
All right, fair
I
enough.
think I'm my choice is gonna be Rexxar.
You don't like
Rexxar,
I like
just gonna.
Rexxar.
I think Rexxar's bad.
He's good. Dude.
I think there's just so many heroes that do everything he
Braxis.
does better. Yeah, he was there for a while. I don't know,
There's
but.
he does something no hero can do, Ryan, and that's be two places at once. Missed. Oh, Sumeru does that times three. Never
Yeah, so
mind.
what you think of
Or
Rexxar is there's two times as many bodies to stack on, right? For
that's true.
quest
Oh
talents, right?
yeah.
But he's not even the best at that because the Lust Vikings can give you three stacks.
That's true. I mean, I don't
So,
think he's great, but I think he's okay.
well, who would you pick?
I'm looking
And
at the
you can't pick either of those other
I'm
two,
looking at the
so.
list now. I'm looking at the list now. I think Chen is useless. I'm not saying that. Let me look at the rest of the list. I might go with Chen.
We have to remember the McDonald's cop from Fnatic.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, that was a thing. Valera. I think Valera because there's just so much inadvertent AoE damage. Like, there's no hero in the game that like gets accidentally shut off like that, you know? Like, so the oops, oh, a little piece of fire hit me. I'm not a hero now.
I definitely think she's down there on the weak heroes
Yeah,
list.
I'm gonna go with Valera or Chen.
Okay. I
Okay.
mean, they're definitely bottom. No doubt about it. So
I was also thinking maybe Lili, but
Lily's got a
in just the
place.
right draft,
She does have a
yeah.
place. Yeah.
In just the right draft, right?
Nice
Yeah.
secondary support when you need those blinds, yeah.
A lot of blind, yeah.
Okay, cool. Well,
All
this was
right.
fun. Those were two really good drafts. Coach D here gave a is that how you want to pronounce Coach D?
I have so many names right now. I am David, I'm Dylan, I'm Coach
Coach. All right. Well,
DI or Coach D
Coach
or
D. Coach D, 'cause that's
okay,
like
Coach
call
D.
that it feels like college sports, like Coach K, you know? You're Coach D.
All right, all right. I
And it's
like
also your Twitter, so
also that.
yeah, it's
So
very funny.
there's a lot of names, yeah, but Coach D dropped a lot of knowledge on us tonight, and we learned a lot about his thoughts on the meta. And I think he was definitely an important part of Heroes Hearth's recent success. And I hope you guys do awesome in the HGC starting in January. And we will definitely be watching and cheering you on and tweeting also. So.
Yeah, but thank you very much for coming on. I think this is, I think, one of the more informative episodes that we've ever done. I learned more in this
Yeah.
last
Well, you have
hour, 50 minutes.
you have a very strong grasp of the meta of how to describe the meta. I think a lot of people, I guess,
Yeah.
know the meta, but they don't know how to they don't express
Yeah.
it in easy to consume ways, you know.
Well, like I said, my job is to put feelings into numbers, right?
Right,
Right.
The words that
So
I.
before we go, if you had one piece of advice for people playing heroes here in Hero League, you've played thousands of games
Draft-wise.
from the bottom to the top, all the way up. What is it?
Okay. For people playing Hero League, I think that I actually have a couple knowledge bombs here.
Go ahead.
So I think first of all,
I need
right,
them.
Yeah, you do.
If you're playing Volskaya, run a kill comp with a split pusher. The objective is terrible.
It is. It's awful.
It is so bad.
Like, so I play Asmodan on that map every single time.
Yeah, that's who I've been picking, too, and I don't even play Asmodan, but I'm like, yep.
And I sometimes even go Demon Army Invasion,
yeah,
right?
Right, yeah.
And, yeah.
Okay.
On that map, Asmodan, right? Mm-hmm. And I also just recently thought of a new way to quantify something called an unwinnable game, right? Mm-hmm. And so, when you're playing Hero League, don't get down on yourself because there was an unwinnable game. And I'm going to tell you exactly what an unwinnable game is right now, right?
Okay.
And so to start out this, it's a mini story. Mini story starts out with, I did a study a while back on Rengar specifically. Mm-hmm. And I did a quantitative analysis, like stats analysis of him, right? Mm-hmm. And I found out that pretty much the only thing that decides whether you win or lose a game, or that indicates, I guess, correlates to whether you win or lose a game, right, mm-hmm. is kills and deaths, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it's about a 5% swing when you get a kill, 5% swing when you have a death, right?
Okay.
All right.
That's a lot, actually, like per
yeah,
kill.
A little more than I expected. Yeah.
If you have an even game and then one person dies, right, suddenly it's 55-45, right?
Right.
Okay. So with that rule, my rule of thumb is don't get down on yourself. If your allies, if you add up all your allies' deaths minus your own, because you can control yourself, right?
Mm-hmm. It's your own death. You can control. Yeah.
if your allies die, right, mm-hmm. 10 more times than the total amount of takedowns your team has, right? Mm-hmm. Because then we've gone from a game that's a 50% chance to win to a 0% chance to win, right?
So 10 times deaths, 10 times the number of takedowns.
Okay. No, 10 more.
10 more. 10 more. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So if you have like 25 deaths on your team and 7 of them on your own, right, then you have 18 deaths on your team, right?
Right.
And so if you have less than 8 takedowns, then you're in an unwinnable game despite you dying 7 times, right?
Right. Okay.
Okay.
So yeah.
But hold on, you grinded from like never playing a MOBA to Grandmaster. I gotta keep you here for a second. I need like, what's a draft tip for Hero League? Because I'm awful. Oh.
So my first draft tip mm-hmm. is pick a tank and a healer.
Okay, good one. Yeah. good choice.
Pick both a tank and a healer, right? Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then pick enough wave clear, right? Mm-hmm. If you don't have enough wave clear, you're going to lose the game painfully, right?
Right.
So if you pick a composition that's Nova, Tracer, Muradin, Uther, and Mayfield doesn't have that great wave clear, right? You're going to have a rough time, no matter what.
Right.
Every map requires some minimal amount of wave clear, and if you don't have that, you're going to have a bad time, right? And so make sure to try to at least get one pick with wave clear on it, right?
Right. And that's why Nova's the worst hero in the game. I changed my vote. No, she's all right. She just doesn't have any wave clear, yeah. But
yeah.
Okay, cool. All
right.
Well, yeah, these, like I said, these were good. Thank you so much for coming on, man.
Yeah,
for
those,
for anybody who maybe came in late or wants to hear the beginning of the show or the whole thing again, I'll be uploading it to YouTube right now. I have last week's episode to upload as well because I forgot. So those will be going up on YouTube. Should be there in, you know, an hour, something like that. Depends on how long they take to process. But, yeah, and that's over at our YouTube channel, which is just YouTube.com/C/StormLegacy. And definitely give us and Coach D here a follow on the Twitter and on Heroes Hearth, of course. His team is Heroes Hearth, so you should go follow him and sign up for Heroes Hearth. We have a little green heart next to our name on there, which means something. We're special. So yeah,
legendary.
Yeah, go follow us and follow him, and yeah, we'll be back next week for more draft stuff. And it was a good one. So thanks again.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.
All right. Absolutely. See you later. Bye bye.
Good night.